They change cultures. They're heat seekers. They run at adversity and embrace change. These are the room tilters.
Somebody who can change the temperature in a room when they walk in. Mm. I mean, that's metaphorical for somebody who can influence those around them and make such an impact quickly, emphatically, and long-lasting, whether it be an organization, a team, a relationship, whatever it might be.
This is the Room Tilters podcast, presented by Limitless Minds. Co-hosts DJ Eitzen and Harry Wilson, founders of peak performance and leadership consulting company, Limitless Minds, explore how the best and brightest change the temperature in a room. From sports, the military, entertainment and media, clinical psychologists to CEOs, this podcast will navigate what it takes to think big and go far. And now, DJ and Harry.
All right, Kabir Shahani, thank you for joining us on the Room Tilters podcast, man. We are really excited to have you. You've been a friend and a mentor for some time now, and really excited to have you on.
Appreciate you saying that, and I'm pumped to be here.
Yeah, man. Yeah, you know, I think we actually really probably met, several years ago, potentially at the Wilson Celebrity Invitational, potentially.
Yeah, I think that's right.
So you've been a proud supporter of the Why Not You Foundation, and we appreciate you for that too. So, and also for those who can't see Kabir, he's got beautiful salt and pepper hair that doubles down how wise and awesome he is. So
Harry, his hair tilts a room, man. Just looking at that, how handsome he is.
I'm trying to keep it all right now, and before I know it, I'm 37. I'm gonna look like I'm 67 pretty fast.
It's all good, man. Well, listen, we wanted to ask you to share some of your background with our listeners, family, where you're from, business background, etc. And then tell us a little bit about, Imparity.
Yeah. And again, Harry, DJ, thanks for having me on. It's really an honor to just even be invited to chat with you guys for a little bit and just the work you're doing, which I'm excited to get into. Just as quick background for me, I live here in Seattle, grew up mostly here, Kansas City for a while before that. My family moved to Seattle when I was in eighth grade. So I like to say I'm a local yokel. I was fortunate to start my first company a few years out of college, which was a enterprise software business that focused on marketing automation, particularly in the healthcare vertical, where I know you guys have a ton of background and a ton of experience. It's a super interesting industry. And we were fortunate to build that company into the market leader within the healthcare life science vertical before it was acquired by IMS Health, which is another sort of great global brand in healthcare. And after spending some time at IMS and helping to give birth to the enterprise software business across the entirety of the company, I decided to take some time off, just as you guys know, running and gunning for 8 years, start to finish. My wife encouraged me that a break was needed. And, it was during that time that I had the opportunity to really step back. It was probably close to a year where I really reflected, less on career and more on life. And it was a really interesting time for us as a family because, it was just the two of us. We didn't have kids yet. We now have two little girls. And it gave me a chance to step back and just say, hey, what do I want out of my life? And what's the purpose behind business? Like, do I care about being a business person? Do I want to be an entrepreneur again? If I do, what does that mean? And that actually took me down a path, as you guys know, actually really closely connected to a lot of the thinking and mindset that you talk about and that you help companies with. And a lot of what happens at the Seahawks. And again, you have the context here of some of the friendships I've been fortunate to form with guys that are, best in the world at this, like Russell, like Bobby Wagner, like KJ Wright. And then guys that, were doing that for a long time and now in the second phase of their career, with guys like Cooper Health and Charlie Martin. And so I actually spent a bunch of the time almost selfishly trying to pick their brains, right? What makes someone great? What creates the opportunity to be best in the world at your craft? And it came back down to your own personal philosophy and your own desire around how you architect your life and the way in which you spend your time. And I don't know if you guys know this part of the story, but part of what gave birth to Amparity was an exercise that the Seahawks do around crafting your personal philosophy and asking yourself some really introspective questions that I went through with my buddy, Derek, who's my co-founder. Fram parody. And we said, hey, let's just go do this exercise together, sit in my basement, sort of talk about what we care about. And through that process, we realized that a lot of what we care about in terms of finding our best selves, figuring out the outer limits of our own capacity, being able to learn and grow consistently, the idea of getting 1% better every day and the value of compound interest when you focus on that, all of those things lend themselves really well to creating a company, an organization. And so the intersection of the opportunity to create an organization that could espouse those values and create that environment with the business opportunity for what we do at Amperity, which is to help people use data to serve the customer, which is a really popular topic right now. And it's a huge market in terms of our ability to create software that helps a bunch of companies that I'm happy to talk about create value for consumers. We said, gosh, you know, there's no better time to jump in and do this. And so in January of 2016, we got the company off the ground.
That's awesome, Kabir. And I love what you said there with that 1% better every day. Where did you pick that up? I love that concept.
I thought I learned it from you guys.
Good answer. That's what I was looking at.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I heard Russell say it in a press conference or Coop mentioned it over a beer. I don't remember. But I do really believe in that because it's tractable, right? You know, we think about, we look at people, whether it's in professional sports or it's in business. We look at people that are, you know, great fathers or great mothers. I mean, we look at people that, religious figures, you know, you can take any part of life and we say, gosh, it's so hard to do that. Like, how can I be that good? And I think when you accept that, and I'll share that I've gone through my own ups and downs on this, but I think when you accept that it's a journey, your entire paradigm shifts. And so when you give yourself permission to say, hey, I don't have to be incredible immediately. I can work my way there. And then you start to say, well, gosh, I'm really busy. You know, I've got two young kids and I've got a business I'm running. I'm doing, well, how do I have time to get better? Well, it turns out if you can make the problem, you know, into this bite-sized chunk of like, I just got to be 1% better today. Mm-hmm. That feels so accessible, right? It feels like something I could do that no matter what. And it turns out, you know, when you do that every single day over the course of a year, you're a pretty different person. I mean, not a different person fundamentally, but you show up differently, or the area in which you were trying to develop and get better, you're actually quite a bit better at in 3, 6, 12 months when you have that sort of laser focus.
Love it. That's great.
That's right. And I think really, you know, internally, you know, we call it the aggregate of marginal gain, right? Just stacking small wins on top of small wins, celebrating those wins along the way. And it's the same thing with challenges and problems, like just trying to turn those challenges into little micro bite-sized issues that you can find a solution for, right? And identify process and behaviors in place that you can manage those challenges. And I think that really that 1% better, that aggregate of marginal gains, shows up really well when we're faced with like a ton of pressure, right? And, you know, whether you're an athlete, whether you're in the military, whether you're a CEO, a founder, whether you're a sales rep at a company, I don't care if you're in IT, if you're an engineer, whatever it is, every single listener of this podcast, even if it's just 13 listeners that we have at this point, right? Every listener is facing pressure, right? It just might be relative to what they're doing, their environment, their ecosystem. But that's something I really wanted to ask you about, Kabir, is, you know, you've had a lot of accolades, right? And I know along the way there's been challenges, but you can't hide from the accolades, right? You've been named a top 30 under 30 technology entrepreneur by Bloomberg Businessweek. You're one of the 100 most inspiring people in pharma by Pharma Voice. You're Young Entrepreneur of the Year by U.S. you know, Small Business Administration. So there's been a lot of recognition of what you've been able to do at a young age. You and I are the same age, basically. And it's that success that oftentimes creates more and more pressure. And I see that with, you know, people like my brother. The more success he has, it seems like the more expectations, the more pressure, harder to perform. So do you feel like those accolades create pressure? And if so, how do you handle it? How do you prepare for it and respond to it?
You know, the short version of the preparation and response is I'm still figuring it out. You know, every day is a new journey for me in trying to think through the way in which I want to respond and how I can process that. I will say I tend to be, just as a person, it's the accolades that are less the pressure And it's more sort of the fundamentals of what's happening in the business, right? And so I think about the Amperity journey as a good example of this, where companies not even 4 years old yet, we've raised close to $90 million of venture capital. We have 120 people here that is growing rapidly to probably close to 200 over the next handful of months. We have some of the largest companies on the planet trusting us to serve them on a daily basis with our capability, whether that's Starbucks or Gap or Nordstrom or Planet Fitness. I mean, go on and on, right? All household brand names. And those things create a ton of pressure for me, right? The responsibility that I have to the people around me at the company, the responsibility I have to my family to show up as the best husband I can be, the best father I can be, all of those things are what create pressure for me. And, you know, I'd love to get your perspective and guidance on how I should handle that, because I think what I'm trying to do is put myself in the mindset of I'm going to put my best foot forward in all of those areas. And I'd say number one is that commitment to myself, right? That commitment to say, I'm going to do my best. And number two, I'm going to demand of the people around me to tell me when I'm not doing my best. I'll give you a really silly example. I walked in the other day after a work dinner. So I was getting home late. The kids were already in bed. And I was on the phone, it was like 9:30 at night. And I was on the phone on a work call. And I walked in the door. Noreen's in the kitchen. I'm still on the phone. I'm finishing up this call. And I finished it up probably 4 or 5 minutes after I walked in the door. And to me, wasn't a big deal. I was on a work call. No big deal. I was only on the phone for 4 or 5 minutes after I walked in the door. So got off the phone, went to give a hug, went to connect. And, you know, she wasn't super happy. You know, a few hours later, it was kind of like this, hey, like you came in and you weren't present, right? You came in and you weren't ready to connect with me. You were still working. You were still focusing on something else. And that was so helpful, right? Like that push to say, hey, you didn't show up as a great husband in that moment. Because when you walk in the door, I need you to be on my time. I need you to be on my team. Is exactly the kind of standard that we need to all hold one another to, whether that's in our families, whether it's in our businesses. And so, you know, what I've tried to do is surround myself with people that, you know, from a professional perspective as well, that I can learn from, that have the depth of experience and the strength of character to be candid about what's required to actually be great and show up despite the pressure and create an environment as a company where, you know, we're all under that pressure, right? And so a lot of my job, I think for anyone leading an organization, whether it's formally or informally, is how you sort of manage the pressure cooker, right? What are the moments in which you want to apply pressure into the system because you need to drive a certain outcome? But what are the points of time where you need to also release pressure from the system? And so that's another area that I'm both managing internally to myself, but also the fact that I'm part of a broader system where that pressure has to get managed up or down, depending on the situation.
So many good examples and things that you shared there. You know, one of the things reminded me of something that happened to me kind of early in my management career. I remember showing up to my house after a long week of travel. And I pulled into my driveway and I was finishing up a call similar to you. I remember my kids being in the window, you know, and at the door.
Yeah, banging on the window. Dad, right. What are you doing?
And you're right. And Kabir, it was like right there, it hit me, you know, and I'm giving them, you know, I'm telling them, hold on 1 second. And I said to myself, I will never do that again. Where I'm in the driveway, you know, telling them to hold on a second because I wasn't present. Although I thought I was finishing up the call and I was going to come inside, they were excited to see me and I wasn't able to be there for them. So now I finished my calls in the high school parking lot across the street and then come home. But I love that. Thanks for sharing that example. The other thing is you talked about pressure and things you can do to handle it. I think a lot of times when we talk to people that are super successful like yourself, you're already doing things, you know, to handle pressure. It's just identifying what's working. And what we see, you know, when we talk to folks like Russell or some of the top executives that we've been able to have the opportunity to work with is that their level of preparation is extremely high, probably very similar to you, you know. And, you know, because I've seen the way you network. I've seen the way you prepare. I know how you know your business inside and out. And so I think that's probably something that you do inherently that you don't even realize is relieving a lot of pressure that people that who don't prepare, the way they feel pressure is much different than the way you're feeling it and receiving it. So
it's a great point. And I think pressure is harder when you feel like you're always playing catch up, right? Mm-hmm. When you feel like you're always on your heels. And so the evolution that I'm going through, and I'm sure many of you going back to this idea of like, you don't have to be perfect today. It's not binary, mm-hmm. right? But you know, what I needed to do to be prepared when our company was 10 people and what I need to do to be prepared now that our company is over 100 people are fundamentally different. And so evolving the way in which I even think about preparation, right? Evolving the way in which I think about how I organize my time is super important. And I think these are things that you have to, and life kind of throws all kinds of different things at you every day. And some days, you know, a journey that I'm on personally is something, you know, I, at times in my life, have been very consistent about stepping back and spending 5 minutes praying every day. It's very important to me. And at times in my life, I vacillated. Yeah. And I might pray twice a week. I might not pray at all in a week. And, you know, for different people, there's different things, prayer, meditation, exercise, you could even put in the same broader category, even though it's a little different. You know, some people are like, hey, I'm working out 3 or 4 days a week consistently right now, and I'm feeling good. And some people are like, man, I haven't hit the gym in a month. And I think part of what the journey I've been on is like giving myself permission to say, like, because, you know, we all hold ourselves to a high standard, and saying, you know, well, when I hold myself to this high standard, I don't deliver on that standard, I'm not going to penalize myself by saying, well, screw it, right? I'm going to just use that next day as a way to hit reset and start doing it right if that's something that I know I need to do because that's who I am.
I love it. I love it. And you're really hitting home with the need to hit the gym because your boy is struggling.
Dude, totally, man. I'm the same way. Like I've got a freaking Peloton in my basement. I'd like when I hammer that thing and I would love to be, I mean, we both know Charlie's like hitting that stuff, you know, 5 a.m., yeah, you know, yeah. Cranking the beast, right? Yeah. I would love to be that guy. I would love to have that level of discipline around it. But I know myself. I know, like, I've got to hit it on the weekends and I've got to hit it once or twice during the week. And yeah. I'm with you, man. Like, I haven't hit it in a couple weeks. Yeah. And
I need to get me one of those Pelotons. I keep telling Russ to let's have some conversations with his folks over there because – I love that thing. And actually, you know what? Maybe what we should do is just say that this message is sponsored by Peloton.
Yeah, there you go. Game changer.
Yeah. So listen, I think that, you know, I'm really excited to get your opinion or your kind of your experience with this. We've talked about kind of this concept around tilting a room and, you know, just individuals, people, teams, organizations that have the ability to change the temperature in a room when they walk in and organizations that are made up of leaders that have that ability to do that. But I think what's neat is that we see that manifested in different ways for different people, right? For like, you know, whether it be, you know, Trevor Mowat, our CEO, or Russell, who's kind of known for his ability to tilt a room. You're able to do the exact same stuff, Kabir. I mean, we've seen you in action. We've worked with you and know you quite a bit. And we noticed that about you as a leader and hence having you on the podcast. But you have different styles of doing it, right? For some folks, it's not even purposeful. It's just who they are. Others, they really work at it. Tell us a little bit about your thought process around it. You know, what you've seen, that whole aspect of some people, it shows up differently for some than others. And who's kind of influenced you in the way that you approach people around you?
It's a hard one to talk about because I don't necessarily think of myself that way, truth be told. But I also objectively know it's true, as conceited as that might sound. At 37, I've heard people kind of describe some version of that to me, to sort of have to now believe that that's the case, and have noticed it myself, right? Like when I walk into a room, I kind of notice the way the energy changes. And number one, I'm not purposeful about it. I don't think about it. It's not something that's in my brain space really at all. I will say, your brother is somebody that I've noticed does this and probably doesn't think about it either. I don't know. I've never talked to him about it, but it has left an impression on me. And one of the few people I have spent time with that I observe a similar dynamic when you know, the room walks in. And I don't think that's a celebrity thing either, by the way. I've been around celebrities that walk in a room and no one notices they walked in the room. Yeah. So I don't think that that's anything to say about sort of fame. I can tell you, as I've reflected on this topic, as we've talked about it, just hanging and you know, thinking through it together, to me, what creates the ability to tilt the room is showing up as authentically you. And, you know, if you contrast the two people we're talking about here, and it's weird to talk about yourself in the third person, but talking about me and Russell, right? It's different example, very different examples, way different backgrounds, way different profiles. He's had tremendously more success than I have in his life. But you talk about that energy, you know, I show up as authentically me, and I'm a sort of naturally energetic, some like to say positive person. And high energy and enthusiastic. And so when I walk into a room, like put differently, I don't walk into a room I don't want to most of the time. Right. You know, sometimes we have to do that, but I when I walk into a room, I'm genuinely enthusiastic about walking into that room, or at least I condition myself beforehand to be genuinely enthusiastic about it. Otherwise it's just hard for me to actually physically do it. Mm-hmm. And so I think what happens when I walk into a room is people feel the authenticity of that energy. And they say, gosh, this is great. I'm getting that energy. And I think, you know, from what I know of my interactions with Russell, you know, he's a energetically neutral guy, right? He's mastered neutral thinking. I think that's something, again, something you guys talk a lot about. And I think he's mastered that craft, and he's, you know, naturally a little bit quieter than I am in terms of like going in, and he doesn't come into a room and, from my observation, try to be somebody he's not. He just comes into the room being authentically him. I don't know if it's just sort of part of how we're wired as mammals, but I think people can pick up on that just intuitively. They know when someone's walking in and comfortable in their own skin and being who they are and bringing their best self, or when they're not.
Yeah.
And that feels to me like the difference between a room tilter and not, but I would defer to your expertise on if that's the case or not.
Yeah. You know, Kabir, I would totally agree with you. It's funny because on these podcasts and with our customers, with the business, we talk about authenticity a lot. And I think just from being around you, first of all, I your love for people is, you know, exudes out of you. And you see that, and you can't really fake that, you know, like I've seen people try to fake it, and it's
all we got, man. Like you can't, you know, what's that Drake song? Like, when I die, put the money in the grave, like you can't take it with you,
right.
You know, like, so like who gives a shit about anything else? Like it's the people, it's your family, it's your friends, it's the people you work with. Like that's the canvas of life is people, period.
No question.
It's treating people that you really don't have, you know, DJ and I, for example, you know, when we first got a chance to spend some time with you, you know, I think, you know, we actually spent time at the Rainier Club. We had an intimate CEO dinner. You probably remember
that. That's right. I do. Yeah.
That was there. We were just kind of getting this idea about what we wanted to do with this business out, right? With Limitless Minds, right? And, you know, about an hour after we left, we were at SeaTac and we get an email from you, right? And it was telling us, you know, kind of giving us, making us feel good about our value prop. Right. You didn't have to do that. Right. And so, you know, just, you know, the communication and your style of communication to people that you don't necessarily, you know, have no obligation to treat a certain way. Right. I mean, other than be a good person. Right. But, you know, you're busy. Yeah. There's a lot going on. Right. There's, you know, you can, you know, you have choices, theoretically, decisions that you can make relative to who you communicate with. And so I think that that ability to have those communication up and down the ladder are really important.
You know what's so amazing? I don't even remember sending you an email. Isn't that funny?
I got it still.
That's so funny. I don't remember it at all. And I couldn't even tell you what it said.
Yeah.
And that's such a great example of this, where when you show up as authentically you, like something that, and this hopefully doesn't sound like a, you know, this isn't like a rude thing to say, like, I don't really think about, like, I just, you know, I don't remember. I wasn't quote unquote intentional about it. I don't remember actually something you do and sounds like it had an impact on you. Right. And I think there's a lesson in that for all of us, which is, hey, like the more we show up as who we are, that actually will impact the people around us in unexpected ways.
That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely. So listen, man, we really appreciate you jumping on with us, man. I think that you provided some really cool insight. And before you jump off, though, we have some rapid fire questions for you. They're not. We always said every caller. I don't know why we call it rapid fire. It just feels good. It feels good to call it that.
I love it.
They're just quick hits, and just to get to know you a little better and ask you some off the wall questions. The first one is: if you had 1 week to travel somewhere, and that was like your last vacation, where would you go? No kids. So this is just you and Noreen just hanging out.
Oh, Greek Isles.
Oh, very nice. Wow. I'll go there. We'll get some recommendations after the call.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Okay, outside of work, outside of what you do as a professional, what are you best at?
Getting the party turned up. Okay. Like when the party's at like a 6 and it needs to go to a 9, tap me in.
Yeah. You'll help it turn it up a little bit. I got you. In your next life, right? Round 2.
Is that an Indian guy question?
No.
Incarnation.
My next go of this thing, I'm going to be like on Broadway or something like that. I'm going to like sing and do some stuff. But for you, like, what would you be? Like, what can you see?
This is not a profession, but I think I'd be a hippie.
I can see that, man. I can see that you've got that in you already. It's just a modern day version of it. And speaking of that, favorite music group or artist, dead or alive?
Ooh. Gosh, I should have thought about this one. Dude, it's got to be Dr. Dre. It's got to be Dr. Dre.
Got to.
Like the Chronic, like that?
Well, just all the, I mean, not just the Chronic, but the Chronic 2001, like just the ability to keep influencing through his own work, but just the way in which he's helped other artists be their best is, I mean, that's true talent.
Yeah.
Room Tilter.
Totally. That guy's got to be. I've never met him. He's got to be a Room Tilter.
Got to be. That should be his next album or something.
You guys should have him on the next podcast.
We should.
Why not?
DJ, you give him a call, right? You know his people?
That's right.
DJ, I'm sure you could get to him.
Yeah, we'll get him.
And the last one is a book you'd recommend.
This is controversial because the guy who wrote the book is kind of, people would say he's kind of out there, but the book content is insane, which is a book called 0 to 1 by Peter Thiel. And it was actually the way in which he thinks. Mm-hmm. And the way he articulates going 0 to 1 on an idea in a market was actually super influential to when we created Imparity. Must read, yeah. Guy's kind of out there for sure, but the way in which he thinks is super interesting.
Put it on the list. Well, listen, Kabir, man, we appreciate it. We're gonna keep watching Imparity soar, and I'm sure we'll see you in the Pacific Northwest.
Really appreciate you guys having me on. And honestly, like, I mean this from the bottom of my heart, I just super appreciate the work you're doing. I think it's making companies better. It's making people better. Really fun to watch you guys bring this company to life.
Awesome, man. Thanks for the kind words, brother.
You've been listening to the Room Tilters podcast, hosted by DJ Eitzen and Harry Wilson, presented by Limitless Minds.